privileged today to introduce our lunch keynote speaker, Tal Keenum. Tal is chairman and CEO of KCPS Clarity. KCPS Clarity is leading the emergence of an Israeli financial services industry of international standing, making use of Israel's unique comparative advantage, outstanding indigenous and immigrant talent. The KCPS Clarity team includes investment professionals from around the world and serves institutional and private clients on a global basis, providing wealth management services and managing funds and individual accounts. Tal was born and raised in the United States, immigrating to Israel at the age of 20. He completed his undergraduate education at Georgetown University School of Foreign Service and at Tel Aviv University, and his master's degree at the Harvard Business School. Tal was a partner at Giza VC, one of Israel's leading technology sector-focused private equity firms, until 2005, when he co-founded KCPS Clarity. He served on the advisory board of the Ariab Commission, a joint Bank of Israel Ministry of Finance task force on the creation of a global financial center in Israel. Tal is chairman of Karet Israel Economic Development Funds, Israel's largest microcredit and small business lending program, having facilitated over 300 million in credits supporting 50,000 new and existing jobs. He also serves on the boards of directors of the Pesek Fund and the Steinhardt Foundation and the Reiv Institute. Tal is a young global leader of the World Economic Forum. He writes and speaks frequently in the press and at international conferences. Tal served in the Israel Air Force as a fighter pilot and formation commander. He currently holds the rank of Lieutenant Colonel in the IAF Reserve, serving in the IAF spokesperson's office. Tal is also married and has three beautiful girls. Tal, we welcome you to the Investment Institute 2000. Thanks very much. It might seem funny to cite Donald Rumsfeld at a JFNA Investment Institute talk, but I want to talk about an unknown unknown. And my ambition for this discussion is to turn that unknown unknown into a known unknown. Because as Rumsfeld said it in that now infamous press briefing in 2002, the unknown unknowns are the place where risk and potentially opportunity tends to lie. I never understood why Rumsfeld was derided for that particular comment. I find that distinction extremely useful between known unknowns and unknown unknowns, particularly as a financial fiduciary, as most of us are. After all, our biggest risks and often our biggest opportunities tend to spend most of their time in that category of unknown unknowns. So at the risk of planting a spoiler right off the bat, I'll tell you that I'm going to be talking about financial services in Israel, financial services for export, but it's going to take me a couple minutes to get there. So moving risks and opportunities into the known unknown category is now getting the right questions on our agendas, so that we can analyze and evaluate them and make our own decisions. Of course, that's not simple. How do we know what questions will be relevant in the future? To guess at the right question is almost a prediction in itself. And to paraphrase Yogi Berra, prediction is very difficult, especially about the future. By the way, I think you took that from Niels Bohr, if I'm not mistaken. So I think the best we can do is often just to expose ourselves to a lot of new ideas, to keep an open mind, and to ask a lot of questions, hoping that some of those questions will end up being the right questions. Of course, asking the right questions doesn't guarantee that we find the right answers, but I would say it certainly increases our chances. not sure we've got the answers right, but I certainly wish we had asked certain questions that we didn't answer.
But more interestingly, let me take us on a small exercise in kind of being honest with ourselves and thinking about what what our position was years ago. Let's take ourselves back to 1985. A good number of us were already in business in 1985, and I think most of the rest of us were probably thinking about getting into business in 1985. And ask your 1985 self, who will pose America's primary defense and security challenge in 20 years? And who will be America's biggest economic rival? 20 years is 2005. Of course, the Soviet Union turned out to be the wrong answer, and Japan turned out to be the wrong answer. Now, I don't remember asking myself these questions, but I have a feeling that had we understood that the present at the time, big assumptions, I think, coloring all of our thoughts on money. Had we understood that the present was a bad predictor of the future, and asked ourselves things like the explosive emergence of the Chinese economy, or the devastating prolonged Japanese recession, breakdown in the Middle Eastern state, or nuclear proliferation, might be likely, how would that have impacted our intellectual assumptions, or our policies, or in our investment position? So here's a thesis for today. The world is organizing itself in fewer and more concentrated centers of excellence. It's polarizing. And this polarization is happening despite the flattening effect of modern telecommunications and the internet. I think one striking example is in the technology industry in Silicon Valley. So, as we know, Silicon Valley has startup companies, attracts more capital investment, has more tech IPOs and M&A events than any other center in the world by far. And what I think most of us probably appreciate is that trend is only accelerating. There is no balancing going on. That is a self-reinforcing trend. In 1970, 10% of the engineers in Silicon Valley were foreign-born. Today, that's over 50%. Over 50% of the founders of Silicon Valley companies today are foreign-born. So Silicon Valley is sucking the best of technology talent out of the rest of the world. A similar phenomenon is taking place in Tel Aviv. If you look at Tel Aviv today, the greater Tel Aviv area attracts more venture capital investment than all of Europe combined. I'm speaking in absolute terms, not per capita. Greater Tel Aviv has more venture capital investment than Europe combined. I think by most metrics, 2014 was the best year in trade tech so far. So that trend is also accelerating in Israel. And just like in Silicon Valley, founders and engineers of Israeli tech firms were born in Israel, born in Russia, in France, in the United States, in Canada, in the UK. Israel is also sucking the best technology talent from around the world and becoming a more polarized, more concentrated center of excellence in technology. I think you can see this in a lot of different areas. If you look at higher education, the best institutions of higher learning are concentrated overwhelmingly in the United States of America, and to a secondary degree in the UK. They are English speaking. The number of foreign graduate students in the United States is growing dramatically. Just between 2008 and 2014, it's grown by 25%. A lot of people stay in the United States, and so we have a self-reinforcing phenomenon. And so on. Entertainment in Southern California, manufacturing in East Asia, finance in New York and in London. So why? What's driving it? So I'm borrowing a few terms from a few different people. You forgive me, but I might forget to cite Tom Friedman and Michael Porter and a few others. I'll try. But I think there are two major effects going on here. One is what I call flat world competition, and the other is the concentration of heritage. BlackBerry competition, if you look at competition in a post-internet, post-globalization age, there is a winner-take-all dynamic that's taking hold in any offering that scales and travels well. Okay, so your neighborhood barbershop probably does not fall into that category. Your barber does not have to worry about competition coming in from East Asia. But if you're in the internet search business, it's a very different story. Or consumer electronic products, or package delivery, or a host of other businesses that have become really exposed to a global competitive field. Part of that is because consumers can comparison shop globally today. There's no reason to use the second best internet provider. It doesn't matter if I'm in Australia, or in the UK, or in Silicon Valley. I'm going to go for the best because I can get it immediately to wherever I am. So I'm comparison shopping globally. And the second is the cost of delivery has really plummeted in many goods and services in the last 20 years. And most of that is due to the internet, because we consume a lot of the goods and services that we do consume today over the internet. So location really becomes irrelevant. And the second is the physical delivery of goods has really been revolutionized and continues to be as we go. So competing with an Amazon, your location is no longer a barrier anymore. The second effect is something I call the concentration imperative, is that we need ecosystems with a lot of different moving parts, and I'll go through a few of those, to really allow us to contend and be global competitors. Okay, so if we go back to the Silicon Valley example, there's a technology engine, okay, we call that Stanford University. Maybe it's not the only technology engine in Silicon Valley, but it's one of them. There's a financial engine on Sand Hill Road, so you have a whole infrastructure of venture capital, which doesn't exist in most other places in the world. It doesn't exist in any other place in the world in that scale and robustness. You have a legal infrastructure, which I think most of us thankfully take for granted, but everything from corporate law to patent defense provides an environment that is conducive to innovating, to taking financial risk on tech innovation. And perhaps most importantly, the concentration of human talent. Some of that's homegrown, but the vast majority is not. The vast majority is imported. And it's only when all those factors come together that you get a story like Silicon Valley. Very difficult if you have one or two of those factors to compete, and that's why most of the companies that we see competing in the next space come from there. You know, just an interesting anecdote on what it looks like when you only get some of the factors in place. I spent time in Dubai. I don't know if anybody's ever been to Dubai Internet City, but that was a very ambitious project launched about 10 years ago with, it looks like, billions of dollars of investment. And what it is essentially, it's a small city. I mean, it looks like a kind of Manhattan, more or less, with gleaming skyscrapers, the best possible infrastructure, the highest bandwidth, everything you could imagine to facilitate the birth of technology companies. If anybody knows Dubai tax law, it's very conducive to starting companies in Dubai. Dubai's got an interesting geography for exporting to all sorts of places in the world. Beautiful by day. If you drive by Dubai Internet City half an hour after sunset, it's pitch black. There's nothing going on there. And there's one element that's been missing from that, and that is the human element. And so I'll get into that in a minute. But that shows, I think, what it takes to really create a hub or a center of global excellence. So we started touching on why one center succeeds and why others fail. Comparative advantage is a Michael Porter term, which I like, I think it works. You find that key factors are found in greater abundance in certain geographies. That doesn't mean that one factor will drive the emergence of a hub, but different hubs have different strengths. So if you think about China, or now maybe Cambodia, Vietnam, inexpensive labor. If you want to compete in a labor-intensive industry, it's going to be very tough locating somewhere like the United States when you have competition like that. The mineral resources, think of Russia or Australia. You know, Israel is certainly not going to compete on mineral resources, although we have natural gas and things. Tax advantages, Cayman Islands, Gibraltar, some special geographical feature like the Panama Canal, the Suez Canal, and Egypt. These can all create or kind of tilt the balance toward a certain amount. But then there's that rarest, and I would argue most dynamic, most potent advantage of all, which is a concentration of human capital. And that's something that we couldn't put together, or they couldn't put together in Dubai. And I think you find it very difficult to find in the vast majority of hubs in the world. You know, I often go to conferences that deal with economic development, and often you hear this term flog the Israel model. Let's take the Israel model to Tanzania, and let's take the Israel model to Moldova. And I credit your book Startup Nation, I think, with you have Israeli currency exposure. Tell you what I mean by that. I'm involved in a U.S. foundation, and I have been for years, that operates in U.S. dollars. Our donations come in U.S. dollars. We run kind of an endowment or a fund, which is denominated in U.S. dollars. But we make grants or grant commitments to Israeli organizations, or organizations that are based in Israel, whose budgets are Israeli shekel denominated. Our commitments go out at the beginning of our fiscal year, so all organizations know what they're going to get at the beginning of the fiscal year. They used to know it in dollars is what they would get at the beginning of the fiscal year. And we're very happy with that arrangement. Until somebody had the idea of starting to measure our impact, not in terms of dollars given, but in terms of real service, lessons taught, etc., really in terms of the mission that we're trying to accomplish in Israel, which obviously is a much better metric. That's really what we need. We're not going to give out dollars, we're going to create jobs and to do the good that we're trying to do. And when that happened, we saw it. Budget and actual. It was a pretty big gap in some years, and that was due to exchange rate fluctuations. So if we committed $1 million in January, that might have been 4 million shekels in January, it might have been 3.8 million shekels by October or November. And that was a real difference in the results that we were getting on the ground. So we were coming up short. And the way we addressed this was to shekel commitments, which was much better for the organization, obviously, because they didn't plan and they knew what they were doing. We were getting a much better result. The problem was that they had portfolio patients for us. Essentially, what we were doing is we realized that we were really asking our organizations to either hedge or figuratively hedge the exposure we were living with. And what we were doing now is taking on that exposure ourselves. And that led us to do two different things. One was to seek very active and dynamic currency hedging solutions for ourselves. And it's not there. The cheapest or optimal solution is a moving target, as many of us know. There's not one way to do that. And the other was to gain some direct exposure to Israeli shekel denominated securities. Part of our portfolio was going to be in Israeli shekels. Part of that was a hedge as well. We, I think, had some speculative reasons to be involved in Israel as well from a portfolio perspective. This, of course, is balanced against a larger global asset allocation, but all managed centrally. And I think our impact has really dramatically risen as a result of that approach. And to us, at least, you know, our feeling was that the only way we could do that was by managing that entire process who understood exactly the implications of that problem are. So that's one thing to consider. One thing to leave you with if you are involved in Israel, it is something I think to consider, again, not nothing to consider as a standalone. I think there are a lot of reasons to look at this. So I'm going to wrap up soon, and I'll wrap up by saying this. First of all, if you're saying to yourself, this sounds great, I'd love to support Israel by investing with Israeli it's the best, if it fits your mission the best, go for it. If it's not, don't. I think long term you're not really helping anybody by accepting second best. That's not what this is about. If you think about it, companies like Teva Pharmaceuticals or Checkpoint Systems, they are the best in their categories, partly because they can only compete at the best. And if somebody is cutting them slack on the quality of their offering, that's not really doing them a service long term. So that's certainly not what I'm saying. But do take